John Sill. I'm the illustrator for the About series and the About Habitat series. I didn't intend to be an artist. I intended to be a wildlife biologist, and I went to school for that. But as it turned out, that did not work out. But I still had all this knowledge about wildlife, and so I thought, I don't think I may try my hand at art again, because I'd gotten away from it. And I just started and just kept working on it. My father was an artist, and particularly a watercolorist, and that gave me a whole lot of technical knowledge from that aspect of it. I didn't go to art school, but it's sort of like living with somebody who's in art school. It didn't hurt anything. So he held me along, encouraged me, showed me how to fix things when I made mistakes. And, I just kept doing it. And through the course of my career, I've gotten some very fortunate breaks of people seeing my art and also criticizing my art to help me do things right. And I just kept doing it. Probably the artist that got me most enthused about wanting to paint birds that would have a life to them is an artist sadly long dead named Louis Agassiz Fuertes, and lived in New York, and was tragically killed in a train accident when he was like 50 years old. But a lot of the older bird books he has done the illustrations for, and just a remarkable artist. I work it out on tracing paper completely. One of the things I like about doing that is you can draw on both sides of tracing paper and see what you're doing. And I work it out that way so make all my mistakes here. And so then when I get ready to paint something, I'll take the illustration, turn it over and go with a soft lead pencil, turn it back over, and then transfer it to the watercolor paper. I paint from a fairly limited palette, but there are some colors that I can't put together and make. And so there are a few of the reds and some of the blues that you really can't come up with. And some of the greens you can't come up with except what is manufactured. And that gives you at least a base to be able to work that with. But it's color accuracy is, to me, very, very important, because portraying something as it is really a goal for a natural history artist. All of the illustration I do, and for the most part the art that I do, is what I call transparent watercolor. It's watercolor that does not use opaques to put in highlights. I leave highlights, so you have to kind of paint in reverse. What I like about that, and my father was a big proponent of that, is that what happens is that the white of the paper shines through the color, sort of stained glass effect type, that gives a particular look to watercolor that you don't find in any other medium. And I like that. I will spend way more time on the background than I will on probably the elements, the focus on the elements. If this is a bird, I may spend 2 or 3 days on the background and 5 or 6 hours on the bird. So it's a lot of it's the volume that you're doing. I paint slowly. Some things in watercolor you have to do instantly. You put a wash on, it's there. You don't go back much. If you do, you start over. But the other parts of it, you can paint really quite controlled. And I paint controlled so that I don't get myself too far into a problem. Blotting is a good technique. If you're putting a sky in, for instance, you can paint your blue, your sky, come back in with a good old paper towel and make clouds. And it does a really good job. You kind of random your paper towel and just take and make the clouds any way you want to. I don't do a whole lot of field sketching, even though I've taught field sketching. But it's what I do. I try to spend most of my time observing and just trying to get enough of a backlog of memory of what I'm looking at. And then I do a pretty good job of then sitting down in the evening or after that and doing a thumbnail or something to capture what I had just seen. And for my camera work, I usually take pictures of the environment, where the bird was, or where the animal was, because you get some information, and I've got lots of reference stuff that I can use for that. But I can't always remember where the bird was. Exactly. What was the structure of this plant? What species was this plant? I want those things to be just as accurate as the bird. The way Kathy pares down information into such simple things, and let's say a subject like parrots. They're a complicated bird and have complicated lives. And so much of parrots that we think in terms of is in a cage somewhere. And they're intelligent and they're social and there are all sorts of stuff going on in parrots. And honing that down into something that for a child is a really amazing thing. And I think it's, and then when I'm doing the illustration, then what I'm trying to do is take that particular fact and expand it to such a way that essentially you're adding more words to that simple phrase by doing a painting to that. And that kind of adds to the information base that the child is getting.
One of the things that I appreciate about John's artwork in the books is that it takes the reader seriously. And I love children's books that have been illustrated with cartoons. But I think for my particular subjects, the nonfiction, I think that the lush, complicated illustrations are full of information, and children can glean information from the illustrations that they don't necessarily find in the words. You know, I think that the illustrations enhance the words, explain it further.
For me, when I look at a photograph, I just accept what's there. When I look at an illustration, it almost takes me into a place that a photograph does not. And I guess because I'm an illustrator, I think, hey, that's a really good thing. And if you want to, you know, put wormholes in it, yeah, if you want to add, you know, some little element, well, some of the illustrations in the books will be a composite of a number of different animals or birds in a particular illustration. You aren't going to find that in nature. So you have to, it gives you the opportunity to compose it the way you want to do. A lot of nature has a lot of good press. You know, tigers, pandas, yeah, those types of things. And I think exposing children to some of the more obscure parts of our natural world is a good thing to do.